So thank you very much for attending our Recession Resilience webinar with myself. I'm Ash from HGEM. A little bit more about me in a moment, and obviously joined by the wonderful Alison Battersby from Avocado Social. So thank you very much for being here. Just to cover off a little bit of what we're going to go through in today's webinar. So we're going to be looking at some consumer behavior insights from 2023. We're going to be looking at improving recession resilience with guest experience management, guest experience activities that operators can do for quick wins, some information about guest experience management framework, and then handing over to Alison at this point, we'll be talking about social media marketing trends, a bit about interpreting the data that you can collect from social media, and then using feedback to continuously improve your social media strategy. So at this point, I would ask that everybody mutes their microphones. My colleague Kate is currently monitoring the chat. If you have any questions as we go through, please post all of those in the chat, and we'll collate those to go through a Q&A session, which we put some time for at the end of the session. So if as and when anything comes up, by all means, just post it there, and we'll come back to you with any questions, with the answers as appropriate. So let's kick things off with some consumer and guest experience insights. So some of you on the call I would have met before. There's a few familiar names that I can see. So very nice to have you here. My name's Ash. I am the head of insight at HGEM. And today I'm going to be going through some guest experience learnings with you guys. And we're just going to cover off what the status quo is in the industry, what's influencing consumer spending habits, how to make your business more resilient from a guest experience management perspective, some quick wins for you guys as operators, and the tools that are sort of available to support you with your guest experience management. So for those of you who don't know who we are, just a little bit about HGEM. We've been kicking around for around about 20 years, and we originally appeared in the sector as the mystery dining company, and we sort of pioneered the phrase mystery dining. About 8 years ago, we rebranded over to HGEM, it's not just about those mystery dining experience, it's also about the digital ways that we can connect with our customers, guest feedback surveys, online review management, and also talking internally with your teams as well regarding ENPS and these sort of things. So we kind of branched out, adopted that technology, and moved on. So a couple of stats there about us, about what we currently do. If you'd like to know any more about that, at the end of my part there'll be some links and stuff that you can follow to learn a bit more about us. So just moving into the juicy stuff, the first thing the last year has been a really challenging, so 2022 in particular has been a really challenging environment for businesses and consumers. So what we're going to have a look at here is what data can tell us about what's going on. So some of the things that are going to appear on the screen now are things that you guys are going to be really familiar with in terms of challenges that we're facing, both from our jobs working in the hospitality sector, as well as consumers who are within that, purchasing experiences and products. So a couple of statistics: the average NPS for the hospitality sector last year was 56.5, and for 2023 so far it's just behind that at 56.1. As well as that, the average Google rating 4.28, and the average Google rating for 2023 so far just slightly beyond that. So there is a touch of optimism. We'll actually cover that in a bit more detail as we have a look at things in this first part of my part. But it can seem a bit like doom and gloom. So I'm telling you right now, there is a silver cloud. And there is a way through this. And as tough as it's been facing all of these issues, these challenges that we've seen there listed, There is a silver lining on this cloud, and there is an air of optimism as we move into Q2 of this year. So we're going to be talking about value for money in this deck, believe it or not. So I think it's really important just to kind of define at this stage what that is. So loosely speaking, value for money can be broken down into two things, and that would be product quality and service. When we talk about product quality, we're talking about the caliber of that product, so the core quality of it when you get it from supplier, wherever it happens to be, and then the skill that's applied to that product, whether it be preparation of a cocktail, the way that a spirit mixer has been served to you, the way that a certain item has been cooked with any level of skill. And that kind of surmises what a product quality. When we're talking about service, this consists of three main components. They loosely are friendliness. Were you friendly? Yes or no? Attentiveness. Was your service attentive? Yes or no? And then the super ambiguous one, atmosphere. So what the heck is atmosphere, and how do we quantify that? We're actually working on that at the moment. So spoiler alert, for some time in the next few months, we'll hopefully give you a more solid answer on that one. But generally speaking, if your staff are professional and friendly and attentive, your atmosphere is going to be in keeping with your customer expectations. The reason it's, I think, quite important to define this is that value for money, when people's purses are strained, value for money has become a hugely imperative influencer, as a core influence on guest satisfaction, net promoter score, a really, really important thing to keep an eye on. When you break it down into what it actually means from a customer consumer perspective, it just gives you an idea of really where to focus on in terms of where your priority should lie in facilitating that value for money and making sure that guests are visiting your venue and leaving your venue thinking that they've got what they paid for. And the interesting thing, in around about April of last year, there was a huge shift from what we saw in terms of how data was linked to NPS. There was a big shift from more typical kind of drivers from businesses, but they were seeing, based on really established data. We know, for example, that a business might say, right, I know that speed is the number one thing that influences my net promoter score in my business. And there was a huge shift where actually just almost overnight, month to month, value for money and all of the aspects that we kind of look at here became much more influential on that score, just because people's budgets were being challenged. And there was that first kind of huge energy price cap rise in April of that year. So without going on too much of a tangent there, we're going to talk about that in a second. So I mentioned net promoter score just now. So we're going to define quickly what that is as well, as it's going to be referenced throughout my section. So loosely speaking, or a very top line, net promoter score is a measure of customer loyalty and satisfaction. And it's calculated by taking the number of promoters away from the percentage of detractors, and it runs on a scale of minus to plus 100. So typically you would see this asked as, on a scale of 0 or 1 to 10, how likely are you to recommend your bar to friends and family? And you segment that by looking at detractors on a scale of 1 to 6, passives or neutrals on a scale of 7 or 8, and then promoters as 9 or 10. And those percentages are then converted to that scale of minus to plus 100 to get your net promoter score. Obviously, a benchmark that is used across hospitality, but many other sort of customer service sectors as well. And a good kind of benchmark for hospitality businesses is around about 55. It does vary depending on restaurant or pub. Pub is like what we see is generally a little bit lower, which you'll see in a second. And restaurants tends to be a little bit higher. Cool. So now we've gone through a little bit of definitions, if you like. Let's have a look at some data. So over the last year, consumers have seen a huge increase in the cost of living, and we've all felt this. So the data that you're looking at the moment is the consumer price index, and that's year-on-year change in the consumer price index. So you can see it was already creeping up at the beginning of last year, and there's a couple of energy price cap rises in there to take into consideration as well. So you can see there's a pretty significant slant in April and October, and those are the kind of points where it all started to change. So April was where it started to change, and then as time has gotten has gone on, things have just gotten more and more expensive. You'll see that actually the data that I managed to get hold of only ran up until February of this year. But the good news is that consumer price index is starting to come down, which obviously will have a big effect on what we're talking about today and will loosen some of the pressures that we're seeing. So when I'm talking about this data, it can be a little bit like, oh God, what are we going to do about it? But, you know, there is a silver lining on this cloud. So we're going to split that down into the sort of two main aspects, I suppose. So the selected aggregates here, if you want to look at the data, it is really interesting. But the two kind of most important things, I think, for demonstrating just how much pressure is put on people's purses and businesses' purses at the moment is the housing, water, electricity, gas and other fuels. So that energy price cap that we spoke about. And also from sort of June onwards, a huge increase in the cost of food and non-alcoholic beverages, with it sort of peaking at the end of last year at just under 17% higher year on year, which is a huge amount for anybody to burden. Even if you're shopping at Tesco or you're buying from a supplier, you know, you're really going to be feeling that. And from an operator perspective, do you take the hit on this, or do you, you know, the argument being, do you take the hit on it, or do you pass that cost on to your customers? A really tricky position to be in when you know your customers have less money, but you need to obviously cover your costs. Where do you meet in the middle when you're faced with such rises? So as the prices are going up, what we've seen is a trend, and the line to look at here is the trend line. Which is that sort of dotted line across the bottom there, is net promoter score is heading in the opposite direction. So as prices went up, net promoter score as an industry across all the businesses that we work with, we saw that was trending downwards in line with that. So when we break this down by sector, we found that restaurants appear to be generally more shielded from it. As the net promoter score, generally speaking, for that sector is relatively flat. When we were looking at quick service, that took a bit more of a substantial hit just after that first energy price cap rise. Pubs and bars equally as well sort of felt that more, with it sort of really coming to head in August for pubs and bars. Obviously, August is a strange time of year, as there's usually quite a significant staff churn in that area, you know, pub service tends to be more formal. So the caveat here is that a lot of the pubs that we deal with are independent businesses, and a lot of the restaurants we actually deal with are chains. So there's obviously that level of difference in the data as well. But it really does kind of paint a picture of the general shielding that restaurants get, and maybe the protection that one gets from the uniformity of being within a chain, and then maybe the vulnerability that you do have as an independent operator on keeping on top of service standards maintaining that sort of guest satisfaction. Nice thing to sort of caveat at the end here is that the whole sector is actually starting to recover up until Jan. And the reason I'm looking up until Jan is because that's when the ONS data kind of ended up to. But in February, and as we're nearly at the end of March now, we are at the end of March, I'm pleased to say that all sectors are actually looking towards a fairly good recovery in that regard. That's what I'm saying. It's not all doom and gloom. There is a positive here. We've had a tough year, but things are starting to improve. So we're going to look at a couple of different indicators here now. So when we look at value scores across each sector, so again, we split this out by sector. Quick service had a much more prevalent drop in scores than others following the first energy cap rise. You can see quick service there in orange kind of taking a bit of a duck. One might say there is an argument that people placed less of a value on quick service and really kind of opted for those experiences where you get interaction as part of that service. So at the top of the deck, we spoke about value for money. And one of the really important parts of that is you're not just buying the product from somebody, you're also buying the service that you get. And in quick service, you can be more open to you can be more open to vulnerability when you have only maybe one or two touch points with your customers. If you have less touch points and you're not nailing those touch points, then the customer is going to walk away from that probably forgetting the interaction, because people don't remember necessarily what they ate, but they will remember how you make them feel. And there's also a similar sort of model in pubs. If it's bar order, if you're just going up to the bar and ordering, and then the food's brought out, and you haven't got check backs, you haven't got those extra levels of interaction that happen as part of that, or should be happening as part of that experience, then again, the guest is left without that sort of human connection and that memory. Obviously, in restaurants, it tends to be that more kind of formal: come in, we'll seat you down, we'll put you on a table, we'll come and ask you everything that you want, and then we'll bring it to you. So there's loads and loads of opportunities to kind of create those memories and those moments. Nice bit of news at the end of that. There is a recovery on the cards, and that data has continued as well to trend in the right direction after a sort of difficult H2 for everybody. Things are starting to come back to where it should be. So if we look at service scores, so this is questions grouped together, similar to value. So I've grouped together questions here which talk about service. We can see that restaurants, are pretty consistent, but the service aspects have slipped in pubs and QSR. So just flagging that energy price cap rise there, it does seem that there was a marginal slip just before that energy price cap rise for pubs. But the data sort of suggesting that the consumers are a bit more forgiving when it comes to value in pubs when service standards are, can be quite formal. And or casual, sort of depending on market placement. And this really does come down to the expected service from guests in these environments. So within this data, as I've mentioned before, there's quite a large proportion of chain restaurants and a large proportion of independently operated pubs. And there's different challenges there when it comes to things like staff attrition, cost of goods, access to kind of bulk service, bulk buying prices, access to being able to bulk buy energy in advance. Various other challenges that are kind of specific to each sector. QSR is kind of jumping around a lot there. As I mentioned as well, that service that we spoke about in value will obviously have more of an effect. Things aren't perfect in those interactions, those handful of interactions, then those scores can kind of be dramatically affected. So pubs saw an increase in the summer, which is great. You know, everyone loves a pub garden. I think if the weather's good, then, you know, naturally people will flock to pubs. So this is what we like to see. And also in terms of service as well, there is a recovery on the cards when it comes to those scores. So value and service are obviously really, really influential as broad statements when it comes to net promoter score. And you can drill down into those aspects, as we know, to understand how the aspects within value and service influence that net promoter score. And you can do that really effectively with data. So hopefully that wasn't too doomy and gloomy. As I say, on the other end of the bit that you can't see is that things are starting to move in a positive direction. So after a tough year, things are starting to be a bit more sort of sunny and warm. So speaking of sunny and warm, I'm going to shine a light on how consumers are prioritizing and spending. So we basically went and did a consumer survey. So we spoke to a panel of consumers, or a large group of consumers, and asked them some questions about their spending habits. So I'm going to talk you through that journey and just give you an idea of how people are prioritizing their spending, and where you might find them spending in your venues and why they might be visiting you. So our journey kind of starts in June 2022. We asked customers how they would prioritize their spending, and staycations were actually the king, and delivery and takeaway experiences were the first to go. So what we actually asked was, if your budget was challenged, what is the first thing you would stop spending on, and then what's the second and third and so on? So on the right hand side there, you've got a rank. So the rank is showing the things that people are the consumers said they are most likely to stop spending on. And the margin is just to give you an indication of how close together those particular points are. So some stats behind what's going on here. So 30% of consumers indicated they would drop takeaway or delivery experiences first. 58 of respondents marked staycations as the most important or next to last which is really interesting. 39% of respondents mark retail as the most important or next to last. So there's quite a big contrast between those two points, saying that's either the absolute most important thing to me or it's the first thing that I would drop when my budget's challenged. And then we revisited this more recently. So this was 2 months ago. We actually saw quite a significant shift. So we asked the same question again: if your budget was challenged, what was the first thing you would stop spending on? Second, third, and so on. Again, that rank is showing you where consumers are most likely to stop spending. And when we did this sense check more recently, we found that customers were prioritizing spending disposable income on eat-in experiences above everything else. So one in three, or just over 30% of consumers said they would drop delivery or takeaway experiences. So a similar sort of thing to what we saw then, but then it changes a little bit. Less than 10% of customers would drop eating out before anything else. And one in three consumers also said they would prioritize holidays abroad, which is the same who said they would stop spending on it first. I think that there's maybe a caveat there is the time of year. Obviously, just before June, people are planning on going on their holidays. They're probably not willing to sacrifice at this time of year. Obviously, asking these questions in January when it's a bit gloomy, I think people probably aren't thinking about going on holiday then. So there is an aspect of that there too. But when we're looking at retail spending as well, again, one in five would prioritize retail spending. So the same proportion of people who said they were going to prioritize that retail spending also said they would put that at the bottom of their list. So what's really interesting here is that eating and drinking out is king. That's what people want to generally spend their money on. Which is obviously great news for hospitality, because that expectation has shifted. So in June 2022, so all the way back then, consumers indicated they'd rather go out less often to nicer places, with males opting more regularly to go to lower cost offerings. So we asked for this particular question: when it comes to going out in hospitality, would you rather go to a cheaper place more often, or would you rather save up and treat yourself to a more expensive experience? So this is what people were saying in June 2020. When we asked this again more recently this year, it was completely the other story. So consumers would rather go somewhere cheaper more often, and it was a similar sort of thing with women wanting to go somewhere a little bit more expensive, but and men generally having more of an inclination to go somewhere cheaper more often. But completely different story there. That whole quality versus quantity thing, classic argument, classic trope, really kind of flipped this on its head. And I think this is a consequence of probably having 6 months of just constantly seeing how much more expensive things are getting. I think a lot of people probably being priced out, or priced out either because of prices rising in the places they want to visit, or being priced out because your energy bills tripled pretty much overnight for some people. So when we talk about the actual dining experiences that people are opting for themselves, consumers appear to view additional courses and extra food items as the most expendable, while drinks offer a real opportunity for upselling and bill building. So building on this statement, we actually asked a question: when eating out, what element of your meal would you be most willing to sacrifice or not order if you couldn't afford everything? And the rank that we see on this particular table is the most likely not to order to save money. So you can see losing of sides, desserts, and starters there, all ranked really closely together. But 70% of respondents place sides in their top three sacrifice slots. Desserts accumulated 65% and starters 58%. 87% of respondents mark their main meal as the very last thing they would give up, which kind of makes sense. I think if you're going to go out, you're not going to give up your steak or your burger or the thing that has probably been floating around in your mind for most of that day. I think you're really looking forward to. But there is some people might say, oh, people are going to start coming in and just ordering a couple of sides. And this data is telling us that they would much rather spend on a decent main meal than try and save money by ordering sides. What was also interesting is the same proportion of respondents said they would prioritize drinks as drop it from their bill. So some people would try and save money by, would say, I'm not going to order, I'm not going to order any drinks at all, and I'll prioritize the food. Or some people said, no, I definitely need to keep that drink as part of my experience. So huge opportunity here for operators is get those second drinks in. When someone says, no, I don't want a side, or no, I don't want a starter, the opportunity to kind of upsell and get that conversation elapses quite quickly. But you can always offer somebody an extra drink at any point in their journey, whether it be a hot bev afterwards or just another drink once you've noticed that their glass of wine or their beer or even their soft drink has gotten below a certain level. And it also plays into that attentiveness. People will remember those things. You've made them feel looked after and those sort of things too. So when we're thinking about occasions, it's most likely that those kind of once a year celebrations and family time are going to be the sort of main motivators for going out on an occasion. So we just basically said, when you go out, what's the kind of occasion that you're going to be going out for? This was a multiple select, so they could select a couple of different things, but 87% of people said that they would be going out for a birthday, almost guaranteed. So real opportunity to make the guest feel special. And that's super important because when you make a guest feel special, they average 83 points higher on the net promoter scores versus those who are indifferent. A real big opportunity to kind of make a anniversary or a birthday, things that consumers are telling us they're likely to be going out and doing, is an opportunity to make them feel special and develop a sense of loyalty with you guys and keep coming back. So we spoke about value for money. Again, we're bringing it back into the conversation. So it's the key factor on deciding on venues. So we asked what factors are attracting you to a hospitality venue right now, and please rank them. So you've got their the rank is indicating the most important factor. The margin there for value for money, as you can see, significantly higher than the one for homeless and comfort and loyalty. But 79% of respondents marked value for money in their top most important factors, top three most important. 42 ranked homeliness and comfort in their top three, and just over a third ranked a well-loved brand, tried and tested, or loyalty, a brand that they're loyal to and know what they're getting with in their top three. People, when they are thinking about going out and spending their money, they're really, really considering, are we going to get value for money if we go to this place? And they're also thinking, we want to be somewhere comfortable. And they're also thinking, I would rather go somewhere that I've already been to and I know is good. So in that regard, it's much better to keep a hold of customers that you've already got than it is to try and win them from elsewhere. It's essentially what you're doing is we're all creatures of habit. Likely, if someone likely someone isn't going to diverge from their sort of special or favorite place that they go to regularly, unless they have a bad time and you give them a reason not to go. So if you protect the customers that you've already got, you can keep those and hopefully mop up those from when someone else is maybe letting the team down a little bit. So just summarizing this section. So customers are much more likely to prioritize spending and eating experiences versus takeaway. They'd rather visit a low-cost venue more often and prioritize a main meal and drinks over additional course or items. Consumers are most likely to visit for dates, family time, or when going out for occasion, birthdays as well. And they're also most likely to choose a venue based on their perceived value for money and existing sort of visit habits. So remember that the important thing there is the perceived value. So this doesn't mean that it needs to be cheap. It just needs to be. It needs to be worth the money that they're paying, and it's part of that product, and it's part of that service that they're getting, that they're buying from you. They are buying the service, and they are buying the product. So, as an operator, this means focus on your dine-in customers, make use of your suggestive selling to ensure the guests' needs are met, but don't be pushy. If they feel like you're trying to rip them off, that's a really important thing to avoid. Focus on additional drinks at a point of check back when needed, rather than sort of pushing extra courses. So avoiding that kind of hard sell, kind of awkwardness that can happen sometimes. And yeah, keep your existing customers happy. And it's much easier to keep the ones you have than win new ones. Essentially, you're waiting for somebody else to kind of mess up in that regard. So improving business resilience, knowing all that stuff, what can we do as operators? So one angle to improving resilience is to actively manage the experience of your guest, and that is called guest experience management. As I said, we are HGEM. So that actually stands for Hospitality Guest Experience Management. So we know a thing or two about it. So just defining what that is, it's a business practice that helps improve and nurture hospitality businesses' relationships with their customers. The idea being that we want to improve the overall customer experience, and that is from, you know, when they're 20 yards away from your front door all the way until the time that they're leaving on their way home or to the next pub or their next part of their adventure or their evening or their afternoon. So all revolves around quality of food, speed of service, ambience, experiences with your staff, and the customer experience that you receive through various channels, all things you've kind of already spoken about as part of this deck. So why is it important to use guest experience management? So use guest experience management to improve overall customer experience, which will get you repeat custom, word of mouth, and also new customers. You use guest experience management to objectively measure operational aspects of your guest journey, such as upselling, additional drinks that you maybe wouldn't have visibility over, just sort of anecdotally talking to customers or when sort of instructing training. You can also measure customer feel with subjective data sources. So using things like feedback sites, social media, artificial intelligence, comment cards, any way of getting that that feedback in. And interacting with your guests, acknowledge their experience, take their feedback, and please the social media algorithms. Number one aspect of good customer service is responsiveness, and that's kind of uniform across any kind of customer experience. So a couple of stats. So 12% is the average increase in reviews after sites start responding to reviews, and that's specific to Google. When a site starts to respond, it also sees a 0.12 increase in average ratings. So that could be the difference between you being over 4 stars or under 4 stars, which is absolutely huge when it comes to Google in particular. And sites with a 4 or 5 star rating come up 9% higher in search listings than those that are 3 or below. So this is that's where that 0.12 can make a difference. So understanding what type of customer you have is imperative, as well as identifying the impression of your desired customer base. So using data to segment that and understanding how that customer is feeding back to you. You can create and retain loyalty, reduce your customer churn, and increase your customer life value. So an NPS for promoter, has a customer life value of 600 to 1400% higher than a detractor. So on average as well, it's worth bearing in mind that when a customer has a bad experience, they'll tell 16 people, and then a person who has a good experience or promoter will only tell 9. And when a customer has a bad time, they'll look for something better and break loyalty with your brand. And there's a really big statistic. So actually 1 in 26 customers is the number of customers that actually will tell you if they've had a bad experience. The rest of them will just leave. So it's important to have ways that they can get this feedback to you. So for every 1 customer that's told you that they've had a bad experience, there's going to be a whole load of other ones who have had a bad time. They haven't fed back to you, but they're going to go to the your competition, the next best place. So data is massively important when it comes to making these kind of informed decisions. What we don't want to be doing is taking single point anecdotal phrases from single points of truth. We want to be able to take it from lots of different places and make an informed decision based on as much data and evidence as possible. So data-led decision making when it comes to GEM kind of breaks down into 3 things, and that would be a subjective private source, such as a guest feedback site or comment cards. An objective view from things like mystery visits or self-completed brand standard audits. And then a second subjective view, which is a public view, which comes from online reviews, also known as sort of word of mouth. And you can use data from those multiple sources to get a really true understanding of your customer experience. And you need to understand your customer experience to effectively manage your guest experience, understanding where things are going right or wrong, how to protect it or how to improve those things respectively. So what's kind of driving Net Promoter Score? What should we be focusing on, Ash? You told us all these things, but what should we be focusing on? So this list on the right-hand side here is a list of typically kind of asked questions from a sort of perceptive guest feedback site. So what we're looking at is the difference in net promoter score between those who score the highest 5 out of 5 for each of those questions, or the lowest 1 out of 5 for each of those questions. And what we get here is an indication of how influential these questions are. So this is obviously the caveat being here that's going to change business to business, as no one venue, brand, service style is identical to another. But we can sort of loosely break the influences down into 4 categories. So the first are going to be those control measures at the top. So value for money and overall satisfaction, similar to net promoter score. And they've got the strongest relationship with NPS in that regard, because they are sort of, you know, they are part of your kind of vital ecosystem. Are really kind of indicative of an overall experience. You've then got your sort of tier one, which are your primary measures. The individual aspects we see there, so taste, atmosphere, attentiveness, and speed, are the next most related to driving NPS. So these are the things that a customer is most likely to kind of pick up on as something that's going to make or break their experience. You then see things like your behavioral measures, the way that your teams interact with your customers. Aside from, you know, the difference between being attentive and being friendly, there is a slight caveat. There's lots of nuance here. But you also have the tier three, the kind of functional measures. So the things at the bottom of the list are, we all know that if the order is wrong, you're going to be annoyed about it. But the reason that it's kind of like quite low on this is these are the kind of things that people are expecting from you as an absolute bare minimum. If you can't get that right, then the other things in the list are almost worthless in a way. If your venue's not clean, you can't get it right. It's not easy to do business with you, like reserving or booking a table or even asking a question. Those customers are going to leave unhappy. So there's a few, based on the data that we capture, there are 3 kind of main actual operational touch points where venues across the industry kind of perform worst. That's upselling, suggestive selling, promotions, and conversations. So questions that are kind of loosely grouped into these areas. When it comes to upselling, an average team member will probably upsell to guests less than 1 out of 3 times. So from a is your customer getting what they need perspective, and also your bottom line in terms of building, there's kind of 2 aspects there of where that can improve your business and improve your customer experience. And there's that difference between suggestive selling, so selling something to somebody who that they might not have experienced already, that might enhance their experience, maybe opening their horizons to a wine or a beer or a particular bang inside that you guys sell, a particular item that is really like particularly good, has loads of kind of staff enthusiasm around it. These are things that can really, really impact your guest experience, not necessarily in a measurable way, but certainly in a way. Reason that upselling could be an issue. It's not limited to confidence, training, and accountability. So, are they confident in what they're selling? Are they enthusiastic about it? And more importantly, are they being held to account if there's an expected service of that they're meant to be doing? Are they being held account to this, and are they doing it? When it comes to promotions, 1 in 5 promotions have out of date offers or point of sale in display somewhere in their venue. And when it comes to conversations, we know that friendliness is a key factor of service and value for money. It's not just if your teams are talking to your customers, it's also how they're doing it. Are they doing it warmly? Are they doing it genuinely? And does it fit the way that your brand is set out? Does it need to be done in a certain way? Or are you quite happy for people to be really casual in the way that they're providing that service? So all the stuff I've talked about so far, you don't have to use those as kind of key measures. You can also generate growth. The end goal really is just generating growth in the right way. So don't cannibalize your future business, not being really pushy with upsells, you know, selling someone the most expensive bottle of wine because you recommended it sort of thing, because that they won't come back. If they feel like they're being ripped off or they're not getting value, they won't be coming back. So there's a few more some included and some more metrics that we use to help measure experience. So we've got value for money, got NPS, Net Promoter Score, we've already talked about. We've also got CSAT, which you guys might be familiar with, or OSAT, very much the same thing. It's just similar to NPS in a way. It's just a really objective kind of overall measure of an experience. And you've also got things like your review scores, how quickly you respond to reviews, and which you are responding to them. So something that's really interesting when it comes to social reviews is that we've seen that sites with 100% response rate, i.e. they responded to every single one of their social media reviews that have been left for them, typically have 80% more volume than those with who are at 50%. And that's just because it pleases the algorithm. This is obviously different depending on each provider. This is certainly the case with Google. They definitely are prioritizing businesses that are responding. I could talk about the Google algorithm in one webinar by itself, so I'll probably leave it there before I go off on a bit of a handle. But it's really, really important to kind of interact with your guests in that manner, and you can use guest experience management to kind of facilitate that. Something that's really important to remember is you don't actually have to spend loads of money to take control of this. So some kind of free or low cost options that you can use here to kind of get your first kind of grips onto this in the first foray is just responding to your reviews, as I said. So focusing on Google and where it's geographically relevant, TripAdvisor. If you're in a tourist town, then TripAdvisor is absolutely a beneficial thing to do. Google accounts for something like two-thirds of all reviews on the internet at the moment. They are steamrolling the competition in many ways. It only seems to be getting more complex in terms of what they're capturing as well. So just take a look at what people are actually saying. So read your comments from your comments card. You know, if you haven't got the facility to have a guest feedback site or something digital, or just have a way that guests can feedback to you and actually take those comments in and read them and see if there's anything constructive or useful that you can take out of it. Clearly define your service steps and communicate those to your teams. It's really important to equip your teams with what you expect from them, because it becomes much more easy to objectively measure that if you do decide to go down the route of mystery shopping or self-auditing. And also, you know, holding yourself to account and just ask yourself, you know, is this journey as good as I expect it to be? You know, start 20 yards away from your front door, and does expectation match reality? In order to get sort of continuous improvement from this, you've got your reputation, so you've got your review scores, you've got your Net Promoter, you've got your CSAT, whatever measure you're happy to use, you have that, that's yours to protect. So if you're measuring it, you analyze it using your mystery guest audits, using guest feedback surveys, using collection cards, and then make changes to your business and continually sort of follow that cycle, you'll always be kind of ahead of your competition, because you're sort of being honest with yourself about what's going on in your business, what your customers are saying, and how you could improve and meet their needs. So a couple of guest experience management solutions that can be used to kind of make this easy if you did want to make your life a little bit easier and use some technology. You can use review management. So you can gather data from multiple sources. You can respond to your customer reviews, analyze patterns. You can use mystery guest audits, which is obviously a really great way of objectively measuring your brand standards. You can use a guest feedback site to get a high volume aggregated data or Net Promoter Score, and then specific kind of feel questions on how your guest feels about their experience and your brand. And you can also aggregate product ratings as well. So you can get like a really kind of detailed level on if there's a particular brand, a particular product that you sell or prepare that makes your guests happy or not. And so, shameless plug here. Obviously, this is a free webinar, so I imagine you probably were expecting a shameless plug at some point, but it just so happens that we at HGM do all the things that we've spoken about in the last slide. So we have an award-winning platform called The Hub, which brings all of these things together using an email-style inbox to bring it all together, as well as a series of dashboards and heat maps. We also use sentiment analysis to understand open and free text to make that sort of a qualitative data quantitative. We can also support you with reporting and integrate with all of your sort of CRM and data partners as well. But what I'm going to leave you on now is just a couple of nice things that a few of our clients have said about us and to us. And if you'd like to know any more, our website URL is just in the top there, or you can scan the QR code on the screen and you can connect with me on LinkedIn, and feel free to ask any questions via that. We can talk on LinkedIn, or we can create an email chain, or you can just give me a call, can exchange numbers and do it that way. Thanks very much for your time. While you're digesting those comments, I'm going to hand over to lovely Alison. Thank you very much for listening.
Wow, thank you so much, Ash. That was fantastic. I really enjoyed that. I think it's so interesting to see the breakdown of what people would be most willing to give up at this stage in terms of maximizing, you know, their own household budgets and what they might sacrifice at the moment, given that we're all going through a really tough time. So good to see some positivity as well. So thank you for sharing that. I don't know whether we had any initial questions, whether we'd want to jump to any of those at this stage, but we do have the chat box available at the bottom of the screen. So you can jump on and ask your questions to us, and Ash and Kate will be keeping an eye on those over the next half an hour or so before we open the floor once again. So I am just going to share my screen and make sure that that is all working okay for everybody. So you should be able to still see Ash's QR code there along with the testimonials. Is that right, Ash? Is that all working? Hopefully you can all see the screen. Fingers crossed, that is all good. I can't hear you, Ash, you are on mute. But do let me know if there's any issues.
Alison, you're sharing your preview screen rather than your main presenting screen.
Has that swapped over?
That's it.
Okay, excellent. There's always something, isn't there, when we're doing these
technology.
There's always something in technology. So let me take a moment to first of all introduce myself. So for any of those who don't know who I am, then my name is Alison, and I run a social media consultancy which is called Avocado Social, which I set up 9 years ago now. I do have a huge obsession with avocados, which you may have guessed already, given that my background is avocados, and green is also my favorite color. So it just made sense. I work a lot with hospitality brands. So you can see just some of the names of businesses that we've worked with, consulted, trained, written strategies for, all kinds of things over the last 9 years. But also we do work with individuals and other kinds of organizations as well, like charities. So it's definitely worth keeping your finger in lots of different pies with social media, because things are changing so often. So what are we going to be talking about over the next half an hour? Well, first of all, I wanted to give you a bit of an update on some of the latest tricks that you can use to make sure that your brand is being discovered more in social media search. So there's some pretty big updates that have happened over the last year in terms of how the social media platforms work, how people are searching for content, and how people are discovering you online. So I'll take you through some of those. I'm also going to give you a few fresh ideas on how to approach your social media content for 2023. And a lot of what Ash is saying around value for money and focusing on the friendliness of your teams and some of the other elements that you can easily upsell within your hospitality businesses can be really important for your social media content as well. Also, listening to the feedback that you're getting via social media can easily be integrated into your social media content too. And then finally, we're going to discuss a few ways in order to grow your audience online using advertising. And social media advertising is the number one way to improve your social media reach. That's how many people are seeing your posts, and also to enable you to market yourselves to loyal customers too. So if you're looking to target people who've already experienced your business, they've already been in for a meal, they know you, they love you, then using social media advertising is actually a really clever way to run ads at a lower cost, because you are already targeting a warm audience. You're not going after people who've never heard of you before. So lots to share, lots to get through. Just a quick reminder that we are recording today's session and it will be available to you all And also we'll be sending out that recording via email to everybody that signed up to today. So let's start by looking at social media stats then. Social media is growing still year on year. We're looking at around a 10 to 15% growth every year in terms of how many people are using social. And those users are using social media more frequently as well. So the majority of social media users are logging in at least once a day, which is pretty crazy when you think about it. Over 84% of the UK uses social media regularly. That's 61 million people on average. And the typical user spends about 2.5 hours a day on social media apps. And that might seem crazy to you, but if you think about the apps that you use, from Facebook, WhatsApp, Twitter, TikTok, YouTube, yeah, it could probably easily add up to 2.5 hours a day. I average probably about 5 hours a day. Okay, I do work in social media, but sometimes I know that if I've kind of gone over about 5 hours, it's been a pretty intense week of working in social media. Users also have an average of 7 social media platforms that they have a login to. And again, if you think about all the platforms you're using, maybe LinkedIn, maybe Pinterest as well, YouTube, then yeah, you could pretty easily create 7 social media presences. And that's important to note because I think a lot of businesses now, they are simply copying posts that they put on Facebook and Instagram over to Twitter as well. And actually, if users are seeing the same thing across all of the platforms from you as a brand, that's not the best experience. So there are ways that you can certainly switch up your content or perhaps provide more exclusive content on some of the apps where you have generated the larger audience. Okay, so let's jump into part one then, social media search. And as I said, the way in which we're using social media has changed quite rapidly over the last few years. Although on the whole, a lot of us do log into social media and have a scroll or a swipe, a lot of us are now going to social media for particular things. We're looking to discover, to inspire, to get inspiration, sorry, but also to find answers, to do our research. And particularly in hospitality, users are searching for experiences using the social media platforms. If you look at these two searches, this is looking at Instagram. And Instagram is an incredibly popular place to go and start a search around, where should I go and eat? Where should I go and drink this weekend? What looks good? And so it's really interesting to see how you can decide, how you can start to make sure that you are appearing in some of these searches. The first thing that I wanted to cast your eye to is the fact that AI is now built into all of the social media platforms and is quite prominent when you look at the search. So the AI within Instagram here is suggesting other search terms to me around things like cocktail bar. So I've got bartender, cocktail bars NYC coming up. And these searches are all based on the keywords that you have the opportunity to include in your biography, but also the keywords that appear in your captions too. So all of Instagram is now searchable. So if you've got some good search terms, and by that I mean the words that you put into your biography, in your biography and also your caption, then you have more chance of showing up in these search results pages. You'll also notice that some of the accounts that are being suggested to me, like Homeboy Bars, Drake and Morgan, also over on the right, Hot Wings ID, they are all updating to Instagram frequently. And a lot of those have the pink ring around their logos, which indicate that they are using Instagram stories. Instagram loves it when you create fresh content on the platform, and they are prioritizing businesses in the algorithm who are updating frequently. And by that, I mean daily. So if you are able to post to Instagram minimum once a day, either in feed, a story, a reel, just something fresh that will help your searchability, your discoverability in the platform. So as a social media consultant, I get asked all the time, Alison, how often should I be updating my social media platforms? And I would suggest once a day if you can now. So it used to be about, you know, 3 to 5 times a week. That has changed. And that's simply because of the way that the algorithms are built and also the competitive nature of social media now. There are so many other businesses battling out for space. There are so many other creators and influencers looking for those eyeballs. So the more frequently you can update, the better. If we look over at TikTok very much in the news at the moment, then it's very interesting to see that this is a huge trend that they are seeing. In fact, Google did a huge study last year into how young people, that's 18 to 24 year olds, are using TikTok for searching. And it's now their primary search engine of choice. So 40% of 18 to 24 year olds would go to TikTok to search for a lunch spot rather than Google. And that is incredibly important if young people are your target audience, which I think for many of us, they absolutely are. So if young people are using TikTok as a place to search for inspiration, to search for recommendations, to search for different dishes, menu updates, maybe even to search for jobs as well, then I think it's incredibly important to have a presence on the platform and to use it for unique content that is appealing to young people as well. So nobody wants to see a landscape video on TikTok. We don't really want to see kind of corporate polished videos on there either. We want to see authentic, full screen, vertical, inspirational, but also comedic content, you know, humorous content that's been filmed. So your TikTok strategy does have to be quite different to anything else you're doing online. The other thing to bear in mind is when somebody does search for you or search for your products on Instagram or TikTok, what is that experience like? What do they see when they land on that discovery page? This is one of our clients, Pizza Union, and you can see that when you land on their Holborn destination, so they have a restaurant at 1 New Oxford Street, then I am able to see a little bit of information about the business. For example, the address, I can see their opening hours. This is all being pulled through from Facebook. So even though we're on Instagram, this data is coming through from the Facebook page. So you've got to make sure that you are keeping all of this information up to date across the Meta platforms. The next thing that I can see is the top content that appears on Instagram, which has been created at this site. So anyone that has tagged in 1 New Oxford Street, Pizza Union, Holborn as their location on Instagram, this is the content. So this might be content that we've created. It might be content that creators have made for us. It might be some customer user-generated content, UGC. It could be some random content that isn't actually anything to do with your brand, but somebody's just put in the location. And if that is the case, you can delete that. You can remove that tag from their content. So this area should be protected by you as a brand, and you should be working to protect these location sites as much as you are protecting your own pages and destinations within social media, because this is what people are experiencing when they are searching for your brand online. Double check your location coordinates. So I have had a few clients in recent years where that point on the map, it just isn't their location at all. And that can be incredibly confusing to a customer. It can be frustrating. It can put someone off. So check your location coordinates. Make sure that Facebook is pulling up the right location. And that, of course, is fed through into Instagram as well. And review that top content regularly. So this Reels video over on the left-hand side of the pizza being cut, This is actually a video which a creator filmed, and that video has had nearly 50,000 views. So we then took the decision to actually share that across to our own page as well, which of course further improved brand credibility. So this could be a destination where you're actually picking and choosing content to feed into your own strategy as well. The other thing that, which I think we're going to see more of this year, is brands really thinking about those captions and using those captions for search visibility. So as I said earlier, last year, Instagram and TikTok both made a massive change to the way that they are built, in that every single word in your caption is now searchable. And I've noticed a few changes that brands have been making to the way that they write in social media. I think Hawksmoor is a brilliant example to have a look at. Here you can see a well-written caption that has been formatted in a number of different paragraphs. It reads a bit like a story, but throughout this story caption, the word Hawksmoor, the location, New York, Chicago, the name of the street, the word steak and British steakhouse appear. And this is going to help their discoverability within search. And it's all written very naturally as well. So we're going to see more clever ways of brands utilizing their captions for copywriting, for search discoverability. So I think Hawksmoor, you know, they could have just written something quite simple here, new restaurant opening next month or next year in Chicago. But instead, they took the opportunity to not only share a little bit of history, a little bit of an update from behind the scenes, but also to get those keywords, New York's British Steakhouse, Chicago, steak, restaurant, American beef, etc., into Instagram. Very clever stuff. The other thing to bear in mind is it's not just your captions that are now searchable, but if you are putting any captions or subtitles on top of a video, then that is also searchable. So that could be the text that you are adding to a video, such as on TikTok or Reels. It could actually be the transcription of a voiceover that you're adding. That is also searchable within the algorithm. So there's lots of different areas that you can use to improve your overall search visibility. Here's a great example from one of my favorite restaurants, Mowgli Street Food. And this is a brilliant way of how they've utilized words in their TikTok video so that they are more searchable. And this video has had over 100,000 views on TikTok. So let's have a quick look at that.
Every time he leave me alone, he always tell me he missed it. He wanted
Okay, so good. I played it twice. I do find that with TikTok videos, they go so quickly that you often kind of have to watch them a couple of times in order to really soak in the information. But that's an interesting one, because the more times you watch a video on TikTok, the more that signals to the algorithm that this is a good video, it's high quality, and therefore it shows it to more people. So shorter videos work really well in social media. So that's my tips for becoming a little bit more discoverable online. Really think about the keywords which you're including in your captions, in your biography, also in the words that you're adding to videos as well. Let's have a little bit of a rundown of the latest best practices for social media content. So things that you're actually posting day to day in your social media platforms. Well, the first thing to note is that in order to get maximum visibility on both Instagram, Facebook, and TikTok now, you do need to be posting every day. Now, that doesn't have to be a completely unique piece of content. It could be a repost. It could be a share something as a story. So you might be sharing a customer's picture as a story. It could be somebody else's post that you are sharing as a story. It could be a reel. It could be something on your feed. So you've got quite a lot of options of how you can update regularly, but essentially daily posts are what's going to make an impact in social media. We always want to make sure that the content that we're posting is high quality, particularly in hospitality. You know, people want that value for money, but they also want a high quality product at the end of the day. And so think about things like the lighting of your videos and photography. Make sure that lighting is good. Natural daylight is always the best. And also think about the framing of your photos. You know, you want the main event to be right in the center of that photo or video, and you don't want to use the wrong aspect ratio. So always prioritize portraits. So you want to take photos with your phone, holding it upright, never turn it. And you want to make sure that if you're filming, you're always doing that in vertical mode as well. If you're uploading to Instagram Reels or Facebook Reels or TikTok, then it's vertical video all the way. So again, you're holding your phone vertically to film. You're never flipping it. If you're going to do some editing, try and edit within the app itself rather than using a third-party app. This is something that's been in the news quite a lot lately. There are loads of third-party apps available for editing Reels and TikToks together. I think CapCut is one of the most popular ones at the moment. But actually, Instagram have come out and said, if you do use a third-party editing tool like CapCut, we will actually reduce the amount of people who will be able to see that. I mean, cynically, the reason is because the owners of TikTok own CapCut. So they do want to reduce content that is being created on apps such as that. The other thing to bear in mind is if you are creating content on TikTok and then just sharing that over to Instagram, again, that's not going to perform well. These social media platforms don't want to promote content that's been posted to their rivals. So the best thing to do would be to film a video in vertical mode and then see how you could potentially use that across the different platforms by posting manually to each rather than setting up automated feeds between them. One of the things that works really nicely in order to get more visibility is by using trending audio. So trending audio, which I'm going to talk about in a minute, will enhance visibility. It will help you to get more views on your content. Actually, trending audio is more powerful now than hashtags. So something to note, still use your hashtags, but bear in mind, if you do add a little bit of audio that is trending in the platform, that's more likely to help you go a little viral. And the other thing to note is where you can think about accessibility better. So it is very common now to add a voiceover on your TikTok videos, but if you can caption that, even better. And that is automatic. There's just a button that you can press on TikTok in the editing section where you can add a caption really easily. And again, that's going to help with your searchability, with your discoverability in the platform. So a couple of things to note when it comes to content. Yes, we absolutely want to see high quality, mouth-watering shots of your food, your drink, where possible, featuring your latest dishes. People are following restaurants, bars, hotels because they want to know what the latest news is. So if you can add any of your specials, you know, anything that's brand new on the menu, that's brilliant content for social media. If there are things that you want to point out regarding particular dietary requirements, that's always a nice thing to mention as well. Particularly if you've had feedback around maybe, you know, offering more for vegan, gluten-free, particularly things like vegan dishes, I think that always tends to perform well in social media, particularly if you have used the hashtags as well and obviously called out some of those ingredients in the caption, because remember, that is all searchable, as you can see on the left-hand side there. Multi-image posts like this one on the right on Facebook, or you'll also have seen those on Instagram. They appear as carousels that you swipe through. They are some of the most clicked on pieces of content in social media at the moment. So other than things like Reels, multi-image posts can perform incredibly well. So if you are doing a photo shoot, then think about uploading a batch of photos, perhaps maybe between 5 and 10 photos to showcase some of your new menu items. Or if you've got a special menu, I think the Instagram carousels lend themselves so well to showcasing a starter, main, side, dessert, and drink. So you could show each of them in a photo and encourage your followers to scroll through those. I mentioned earlier that trending audio can really help to enhance the visibility of a video. Instagram Reels might seem a little bit scary because there's just so much content that's being produced in Reels at the moment, and there's so many editing options available to you. But actually, all you really need to do is stitch together a series of different clips just filmed on your phone. I'm going to show you this example from the pig in a moment, but this is a very simple style of reel that I think everyone can do. Just a tour of a space in your hospitality venue, whether that's a guest room, walking into your restaurant, a cozy snug area of your pub. So let's watch this video and then I'll talk about a couple of things that work really well. Okay, so hopefully you can see that's actually quite a simple video that's been put together just with simple pans of different spaces. And then of course, using Instagram Reels, all of those can be very easily stitched together within the app. So you'd film on your phone and then import those into your reel and then add the audio, which at the time was trending. So this was a cover of Shape of My Heart by Sting, which an online Instagram kind of musician had created. The track was trending at the time. The other things that the pig has done here is you can see in the caption, they've included some really important keywords like the stable yard at the pig at Coombe. They've also included the name of the room, the horse box, and a few details about it. We've got their hashtags, including their branded hashtags, which are important if you are using a certain brand name consistently. The pig hotel, the pig at Coombe. We've also got location-based hashtags, and we've also got hashtags that people would be searching for, like hotel, stay, food, things to do in Devon. I also love the fact that they've included a call to action for extra engagement. Tag someone below who you know would love to stay in this room. That's something really simple that you can do with a lot of your posts, just to try and prompt people to share this to more customers. So some really nice best practices there. Okay, so going on to the next slide, you can see here I've been talking a lot about trending audio. In both TikTok and Instagram, you will know if something's trending because you can see that there is a little arrow in the bottom left-hand corner. So next to the name of the audio track, you'll see a little arrow pointing upwards, as you can see here, which indicates that this audio is trending. So you'll only see that on videos where the audio is obviously being used by a lot of videos at the moment. If not, it's just a musical note. So look out for the difference there. And as I said, using a trending audio track on your reels can really, really help with the visibility. It's not going to, you know, magically get you hundreds of thousands of views overnight, but it will certainly help. And if you've got a good bit of content, you've written a good keyword-rich caption, included a couple of hashtags, and used the trending audio, it's almost the cherry on the icing there that will really, really help the visibility of your video. I love Neat Burger as a brand. I think they're doing some brilliant things on Instagram and TikTok. They are the vegan burger brand owned by Leonardo DiCaprio and Lewis Hamilton, or invested by. And they do create some really good Instagram reels and they follow a lot of the best practices. So they're a good one to go and have a look at. one of the things that they do regularly, which I think is really important, is they will put the information about the video, so the key kind of title of the video, what's going to capture their audience's attention, right in the center of that reel. So you can see here, 50% off, Buffalo Gang, every day, 3 till 5. It's right there, right in the middle of the reel. And that is apparently where the user's eye goes to first. So if you've got an important call to action to share in Instagram on your reel, get that right in the middle of the video and make sure that that flashes up for the first couple of seconds of the video. Don't kind of tuck it away right at the top, or even worst case, you're tucking it right at the bottom, because that's actually where the information about your name and your caption goes. So you don't want to make sure that, you want to make sure that everything's visible and easy to read. So following trends works really well in terms of audio. And actually, if you're a bit stuck kind of looking for some of those trends and want a bit of inspiration, I'd really, really recommend having a look at this blog, which I'm about to share in the chat. They actually put some of the biggest trends up on their blog every week on Instagram. So not only audio, but also kind of memes and things like that work really nicely. And yeah, they'll just give you a few ideas of the sorts of reels and also TikToks as well that you could be sharing on your platform. I noticed that a couple of you had maybe some sound issues. So I'm actually just going to reshare my slides again and just make sure that I am sharing the sound as well, which I didn't do last time. So I think that's probably why a couple of us were having issues there. So apologies for that. So I'm now just going to show an example of a video which has a voiceover on it. I'm sure you'll recognize the voice. It is the chef Tom Kerridge. But he has added the captions to this video, which, as I said earlier, really easy to do just in the editing feature of TikTok. But this really does enhance visibility as well, because the words which are spoken and appear on caption are searchable by the algorithm. So I will just hit play now.
And flour sausage rolls, look at these. First, we mix the homemade sausage mixture. Then we roll out, shape, and trim the pastry to size. Then we pipe that amazing meaty filling, and then roll the pastry over. Repeat the process, and then trim the excess pastry. Portion them into individual sausage rolls, and coat them with an egg wash. Each one is finished with a sprinkling of onion seeds and served with a lovely mustard mayonnaise. And of flour sausage rolls, look at these. First, we mix the homemade sausage mix.
Okay, so a couple of things going on there. I mean, he mentioned the word sausage rolls multiple times, which I'm sure was natural, but that has obviously helped visibility if someone's searching for sausage roll or sausage roll recipes on TikTok, which they might well be. The second thing is the music track that they've got in the background. He has added a Harry Styles track there. I understand, you know, this isn't going to be available for all businesses to use, but if you are using a personal account on TikTok, which Tom Kerridge would be doing here, then you do have access to much more music songs than a business account. And that's due to commercial limitations with a lot of the record companies. So using a trending track has helped. And also, I just think it's quite a nice video. You know, it's showing behind the scenes here. It's quite high quality, just shot on phone, but really does showcase the process of how they go about creating these sausage rolls at the hand and flowers. Okay, so a few ideas for you there. I can see some questions.
And flowers, sausage.
So if you have got a question, I will be answering those in just a couple of minutes time, as just after we finish off our final section of today's webinar, which is all around social media advertising. So if you're not already advertising in social media, then this is one of the biggest opportunities you have to expand the reach of your social media content, to create more loyalty amongst your customers and also to essentially just promote your message far and wide to more audiences who haven't heard of you before. Social media advertising is constantly updating, and there are always new formats for you to explore, including new ways of buying ads and reaching your ideal target customer online. One of the biggest updates that's happened in the last couple of months is that both Instagram and TikTok have just announced that they are now going to be doing search ads. So I mentioned at the beginning of my section that the way which we use social media has changed. More of us are using the platforms as the way to search for things. And so Instagram and TikTok have recognized this behavior, and they are now offering or about to offer the opportunity for businesses to appear after a customer has searched for something. So I could bid on the keyword cocktail bar if I want my cocktail bar to appear at the top of search in Instagram. So it's exactly the same way that Google Ads works, but of course this is on a social platform. So this is incredibly powerful, and I think we're going to see some really exciting things happen later on this year. It's not currently available yet. They're testing it. So keep an eye out for this. And if you are already spending in social media advertising, then this is definitely something to adjust your strategy towards and have a think about which keywords you would bid on at this stage. If you've never advertised before in social media, then this is definitely something to consider as part of your strategy. And have a think about, you know, again, which keywords would you be bidding on? Ash mentioned in his presentation that a lot of, you know, the reasoning why we would be going out to enjoy food and drink at the moment is for special occasions. You know, it is perhaps a birthday or an anniversary, and that is definitely something to consider as part of your advertising strategy. On Instagram and Facebook, you can target people who have a birthday coming up. So you can target people who have an upcoming birthday, which could be, you know, anytime in the next few weeks, or you could target people who have a birthday coming up in a particular month. So right now I could be targeting people who have April or May birthdays. So that is really, really powerful. And you can see the sizes of the audiences available there in the UK. So over on the left, there are over 700,000 people who have an upcoming birthday at the moment, who are aged 18 to 65 plus on Facebook, who are available to target. And over on the right, 1.3 to 1.5 million people have a birthday coming up in April. So that just seems like a no-brainer in terms of, you know, getting your messages about your event space, your special menus, the amazing experience that you could have on your birthday at your hospitality venue. The other thing that Ash mentioned was the fact that it's actually far easier to attract customers who already know and love you and get them to return to your business and, you know, really drive that loyalty amongst your customers. And 77% of marketers are using retargeting as part of their advertising strategies on Facebook and Instagram. So what does that mean? Well, this is the ability to retarget someone with an ad who has already visited your business. There are a number of different ways that you can tell Facebook and Instagram that somebody has already experienced your business. You can target people based on your own data. So at the top here, you can create what's called a custom audience for your adverts, which means you're using your own data sources. You're targeting people who've maybe already been on your website. Maybe they're in your email database. That would be your customer list. Or perhaps they've downloaded your app if you have an app for your restaurant, hotel, or business. So you can use your own sources and plug those into Facebook. Or you can use Meta's sources. And Meta's sources are where you are using the audiences that are engaging with you in social media right now. You can target anyone that has engaged with your Instagram account or your Facebook page within the last year. So that is a huge opportunity for you to start utilizing all of these likes, these comments, these shares, these saves that you've been building up over the last 365 days. You can also target people with ads who've watched particular videos that you've posted, who've attended certain events that you've promoted using Facebook or Instagram, or even that have used some of your shopping features if you do have an Instagram or Facebook shop. So there are lots of different ways that you can connect with and attract people back to your business that have already known and experienced you before. And that is, I think, the most cost-effective way of using social media ads, because as I said earlier, this is a warm audience. They've already engaged with you before. One of the best things that you should be doing in social media advertising is not just using one ad and hoping that you've got the right ad and that it works and that that video is going to attract people to your business, but test and learn. Try different ad formats. Try a video, try a carousel, try a reel, try a single image, test and tweak your copy. So this is a bar in London and they had over 180 adverts when I looked at them. That does seem quite excessive. I would say most businesses I'm working with have somewhere between 10 and 30 ads live at this stage, at any current point. But this means that you can test and learn with different messages, different creatives, and really find your sweet spot. One of the other things to bear in mind about your ads is you want to make sure that you are using some of the styles and trends that are actually appearing on Instagram and TikTok right now. I really liked this advert I saw yesterday from, or yesterday or the day before, from Coach Brasserie. I thought the video really met the current trends that we're seeing on Instagram Reels. So let's watch that really quickly now. Okay, so it's short, it's funky, it's to the point, it's using high quality visuals, and we've got that text appearing in exactly where we know the customer is looking, steak soiree. So to recap, also just on my final point, I know we're running out of time a little bit, but do keep an eye on your quality ranking scores, which are available when you're running ads. These appear as different columns in your ads dashboard, but you want to make sure that your ads are obviously performing above average. If they are average or below average, then you probably need to have a look at that creative again and look at your call to action. So to recap, consider your social search strategy, the keywords, your bio, and the hashtags you're using. Post daily, if possible. Prioritize reels as content. Research trending audio, and I gave you that blog to have a look at, but also look for that upwards pointing arrow. Create custom audiences for your advertising and test fresh advertising creatives regularly. So we're going to open the floor very quickly to some questions. If you do need to hop off, then no problem. This session is being recorded, so we will provide you with that. But if you want to get in touch or talk to me about anything related to social media, then you can do via my website, avocadosocial.com, or you're all welcome to join our free Facebook group, which is for social media chat and conversations, which is the Avocado Facebook Hub. So have a look at that, just search for it in Facebook or use the bit.ly link there. So we're now going to open the floor to Q&A. I know there were a couple of questions that came through for me. So I will just have a look at those in a second. But Ash, was there anything that you wanted to answer while I just get those open?
Thanks, Alison. I really enjoyed that. Thank you so much. I won't go on too much, but it looks like all the questions are for you. So either I was really thorough or very boring, one of the two.
There's always a million questions about social media as well. I think just because it is such a ever-changing landscape, isn't it? Mm-hmm.
Absolutely.
So I can see a question came through from Andrew. Are there platforms you would recommend dependent on the age of the customer base? Is it best to focus on Facebook if you have an older demographic? Yes. So we can definitely see that younger audiences are more drawn to Instagram and TikTok. I would say if you're targeting anyone over the age of 35, then Facebook is a good one to be present on. Instagram tends to be 18 to 35 as their sweet spot. And then TikTok goes a lot younger than that. But of course, there are anomalies as well, and you might have quite a mixed audience. So in that case, it's worth being present on a couple of platforms. Ellen says, we're a restaurant in North Wales. The Welsh language is very important to us and our local customers. Is it better for us to make one bilingual post or two separate posts that say the same thing? I work with a couple of European brands who are sharing content in multi-language. The best thing to do would be to put both languages in one caption. So it's up to you whether you start with Welsh, which might be quite cool, or and then do English translation below. But do it one post and then two different versions in that same caption. Monica says, I edit in InShot as I find it easier and then I upload to Reels as a single video. Does that affect it getting prioritized? Apparently, yes. So this is news that's only come out from Instagram kind of behind the scenes last week. They want you to edit in Instagram. I think the best thing to do would be test and see. So do one video where you use InShot, one video where you use Reels editor, see what the difference is. And Viv says, does it affect the prioritization of video content when you shoot in video as opposed to videos taken with your camera? So it's more the editing that they want to happen in the app itself. The actual shooting of the video, it doesn't matter whether you take that within Instagram itself or within your camera. So it's more the editing that affects the prioritization. Cool. I hope I've answered everybody's questions. We do have a feedback form, which we've just shared in chat, that we would really appreciate your feedback on so that we can improve these webinars and bring you more over the next over the year ahead and coming months. So we'd love to hear what you thought and if there's anything we can do to improve the sort of content that we're bringing you as well. The recording will be sent out within the next 24 hours. So keep an eye on your email inbox for that. And it will come from the team here at Avocado Social. And if you do have any follow-up questions, then you're so welcome to get in touch with Ash and myself. So hopefully everything's really nice and clear, but we always love to hear from you too. So do let us know if there's any follow-up questions.